find you. If you ever find yourself lost in the dark and you can't see, I'll be the light to guide you. If you find out what we're made of, when we are called to help our friends in need, you can count on me. Like 1, 2, 3, I'll be there. And I know when I need it, I can count on you. Like 4, 3, 2, and you'll be there. 'Cause that's what friends are supposed to do, oh yeah.
Well, good afternoon, everybody, and a very warm welcome to this fourth in the series of Firing Up the Future webinars. And for those of you who are new to the series, great to see you here, and a very warm welcome. For those who have been with us before, I hope you've enjoyed this and taken a lot from it. So preparing for the post-pandemic world, as Ian Anderson said, certainly my first pandemic. I might be the oldest of the group here, but the previous pandemic predated me. We have a tremendous panel this afternoon. I'm delighted to be joined by Katie Gordon, Katrina Stewart, Professor Mervyn Bain, and Cameron Gordon, all of whom are, I will give more detail on in a moment. I'm going to just briefly introduce my panelists. Katie Gordon is currently studying a master's in business and Spanish. Cameron Gordon is a business development executive at Data Lab, having previously studied engineering. Professor Mervyn Bain is a professor at the University of Aberdeen. And Katrina Stewart is an award-winning creative photographer and has a varied background. Before getting into the detail of talking about everybody's career, I'm just going to throw to the panelists, did anyone know what they intended doing when they left school? I know from my perspective, I remember finding it amusing that one of the boys in my class, when asked what he was going to do when he left school, he said, catch the number 18 bus home. And that was probably a very honest answer. I didn't know what I was going to do. I nearly studied medicine and didn't do that. Did any of my panelists know what they were going to do when they left school?
Well, I think I'll take that first because I think of myself as a relatively recent leaver, 5 years, and I'm still in education, so I suppose that maybe counts for something. And I suppose when I left Gordon's, I did know what I wanted to do. I did know that I was going to be very languages orientated. I knew that it was business. I knew that I wanted to travel in a very broad sense. So choosing university degree was fairly simple. I knew what it was going to be. But now, coming to the end of university, I'd have to agree with you there and say, no, I haven't a clue. you know, it's not really tailored me in, you know, into one direction any more specifically than I was maybe at school level. But I still have broad plans, which I think is something to aim for at this point in time.
And I always think it isn't a problem if you don't know what it is you're going to do. I'll maybe come to Mervyn. Did you know what you were going to do left school?
No, absolutely not. No, I really didn't know what I was going to do at all. I guess it was what you described was quite a good way of describing myself as well. At the end of school, I wasn't really sure. And I guess maybe like Katie as well, even at the end of a degree, also perhaps wasn't too sure as well. Because, I mean, I think the really important thing is, I mean, I know I'm aware that, you know, I was very different 15, 16 to what I was at 22, 23. So I think, you know, it's not to worry or panic if you don't know, because you're learning a lot of different skills through degrees, and not just the specifics of it as well, but no, I had absolutely no idea where I was leaving college, what I was going to do.
We'll come back to that, learning new skills. Katrina, did you have it all mapped out?
No, still don't. Fell into doing law, really enjoyed the study of it, less so the application of it. So I moved into a kind of public policy role where I could take some transferable skills from my law degree with that. And now, 20 and a little bit years on, I'm in the creative industries, which if somebody had said to me when I was leaving school, this is what you'll be doing, I just would never have believed them. So it's an evolution.
And I'll come back to that transition there. Cameron, welcome.
Thanks, Bob. I think I did out of school, but not because I'd thought about it, if that makes any sense. Uni was where I was headed, and I hadn't really questioned that. I think it was out of uni that I started to actually question, is this what I want to do? Is this what I enjoy? Is this what I'm really passionate about? So yes and no, depending on when you ask me.
Yeah, and the word thank you, and the word passion's come up a couple of times there, and I think we'll revisit that. You've all touched briefly upon your journey there. Through school. I'd stress to anyone who is in the audience, university is a great opportunity to develop, but it's not the only way forward in life. So please don't, if you're tuning into this, don't think you have to go to university. I'm lucky enough to have been at university. I served on the university court, but there are many roads through life. So please don't be listening in thinking that has to be the way. I think the word passion that was mentioned there is absolutely critical. And sometimes it takes time to find it. So Katrina, I'll maybe come back to you. You've touched upon that journey. Maybe you could tell us just a little bit more about that evolution that you've had there from law going forwards.
Yeah, it certainly wasn't planned. So I initially started off in law. Like I said, I worked in oil and gas, didn't really like it, and quickly moved into working for Aberdeen City Council in children's services, and dealing with contracts. Got a lot more out of that. That was definitely a lot more along my passions. And I moved into a development role from that, looking at planning and policy, which I really enjoyed. But when I had my first child, I took a step back then. It was a job that required quite a lot of emotional energy and investment, and maternity leave kind of gave me a bit of breathing space to think about where I wanted to go and how I wanted life to be. So I took a significant gap out of the employment sector then, gave myself time to follow some passions, and that was photography. And with support of kind of cheerleaders and mentors have formed that into a business.
But clearly, you've used the word passion again. And if you had, in your final years at school, sought to define what you now do, I suspect that would have been quite difficult to do.
Absolutely. But every single job I've had has led me to where I am now. And I've taken skills from each and every one, including my part-time jobs. You know, I think about working in the nightclub and how I didn't think that was relevant to my professional career, but goodness me, it gave me plenty of experience of thinking on my feet and managing staff in difficult situations. Everything has contributed to where I am, so nothing's been wasted.
And I think that's a really important point when we're living through this disruption, and you know, it is a very uncertain time, whichever generation you're in. It's about having the mindset that taking the positives from the experiences. I often think you might not be having the experience that you wanted, but you need to learn from it and take things from it. Mervyn, maybe come to you. I've touched upon university and, dare I say, said it might not be the answer for everybody. I'm not going to ask you to defend that that position, but you clearly you have a, you know, fascinating position within a university now.
I mean, I think it goes to what Katrina said as well. It really is, you know, as you said this yourself as well, I don't think it matters if it's university or not, but go with what you're really interested in. Because what this isn't too negative, but every job, you're not going to like all parts of it. But as long as there's something, some parts that you're really, really interested in, and that's the big thing, I think, as well. You know, for myself, I've been very lucky with the topic I've done. It does actually go back to Gordon's and what I did at school. It's kind of evolved since, but it's really being interested in that. Because there's other bits I don't enjoy so much, but it's just the nature of it. So it's really having that passion as well. I mean, I kind of hinted at as well. I mean, I think maybe Katie would agree that I think university is excellent for just trying things. So that's why I would always say to everybody, you know, don't worry. There's systems built in at university. You can try different things. So if something doesn't work out one semester, well, fine, just change it. Always go with what you're most interested in. Because I know myself, if I'm interested in something, I'll probably do a better job and enjoy it more than something I have to do as well. So I think it really, the word passion is really important for just everything that we do.
There's a really good point that you've made there that I think I would emphasise for anyone at the moment who is at university or uncertain about choice of course. You know, you've said that there is opportunity to change, and it is about finding your way. And if you find something that you believe might be more interesting than your current choices, it's usually possible if you really want to do it and you can convince people that you can change.
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it really is just, you know, in a way, maybe sounds quite simplistic, but always go with what you enjoy most when you've got the choices. And maybe it'll take a little bit longer to find what you really enjoy, but it's always that's the safest thing to do.
Yeah.
Yeah, I totally agree with what you guys are saying there about how it's the path and it's what you're getting out of it that matters. And that often is positive. You know, you've got to draw the positives out of any experience. But I think also a lot with university or school specifically, it actually tells you what you don't want to do. Maybe what the experience has led you to believe that actually that isn't the right path. Well, for example, me and my boyfriend went through school together and through university. We took the exact same hires. We took almost identical advanced hires. We both did international business with Spanish at universities in Scotland, and we're both now on completely different paths. He's doing his chartered accountancy, and I couldn't dream of anything more boring than doing a chartered accountancy. Sorry, Harry, but that sounds awful. And, you know, I'm going to probably pursue languages and marketing, a bit more creative side of it. So I think, you know, we went through Gordon's, we went through university, but we're on completely different paths based on the choices we've made, both positively, what we enjoy, but also actually I don't fancy that. So I think that kind of is a point to learn for people as well. It's a learning curve through everything.
I feel I should make a shout out for the creative accountants out there, but I'll move swiftly on.
I'm not bashing anyone.
I'll move swiftly on to Cameron. You studied engineering, I believe, and you're on a bit of that trajectory, but it's certainly not full-scale engineering in the way you maybe envisaged.
Absolutely not. Not in the way that my peers from uni are now working for, you know, the pick an engineering company in an industry off the top of your head, and that's where, you know, you kind of think engineering and that's where you go. I came out going, I really enjoyed that. I like building things. I like supporting things. I think that's what I got. I enjoyed the group projects. I enjoyed working with others. And as Katrina said, working and managing a nightclub, I worked in a bar when I came out of uni. And actually from that, I picked up, I really like speaking to people. Doing this engineering piece is great, but I really love hearing people's stories and hearing what they're passionate about. And that kind of started me through, well, how do I support their passion? And that's kind of how I've ended up with the Data Lab, supporting other people to do what they want to get to the point they want to get to.
And much of life and learning is about storytelling. It took me probably several decades to realize that. But I'm going to pick up on one specific point now. We've got here a unique opportunity. We've got Professor Bain, and we have a current student with Katie. Clearly, since March 2020, life's been turned on its head for everybody, but students in particular have gone into a completely different way of learning. I think it would be great if you could share some perspectives on that, and I'll maybe begin by asking Katie. I'm not saying Mervyn's got the right of reply, but ask you, Katie, just to tell us a little bit about your experience through that time.
Yeah, so I had, turbulent is the correct word for that. I was in Madrid on my year abroad, loving the sunny life, having a great time, and COVID hit. So we went online. Well, in fact, actually Madrid closed the schools. So the universities were shut. And on spur of the moment, or it was maybe already planned, I don't remember, but I just went home for the weekend. And little did I know, I wasn't going back to Madrid after that. Started online learning, which was hard enough in Spanish, and the courses and the culture difference there about how they kind of operate online learning. And at that point in time, we didn't know if we were going to go back in this academic year, because that was still the end of last academic year. So there was always that uncertainty about, like, if we were ever going to go back to uni, because this is obviously my master's year now, so I'm not planning on doing any other years. It was my final year, so it was like, are we going to go back? Am I going to be able to see everyone for the final year? And it's actually, there hasn't been that certainty at all this year. Almost every week it's like, are we going to go in next week? Will we have exams this term? Will I see professors? Will I do my Spanish oral online via Zoom? Or will I be in a classroom, you know, as a presentation? There hasn't been that certainty at all, which I think reflects general life, but it has made kind of the learning quite difficult to keep up with and like keep the energy going about, because there's just no certainty.
Yes. How many of your fellow students and lecturers have you met in person?
None this year. Not one. I was in a fortunate enough position that my Spanish classes are small, so I know the professors well. I know my class well. But for my business lectures, there's 200 of us in a class. If we do Spanish with them, I'll know them. But other than that, I'm never seeing those folk in my life again, realistically. And I'd never had the lecturers before, so I didn't know them either. And to be fair, give them their due, all the professors were in the same situation. So they adapted really quickly and, you know, were obviously doing their best and everything they could for us in the moment. But in reality, it doesn't make it that much easier to sit on Zoom watching a lecture and not really knowing anyone.
I think you lose, one of the things that you lose is the spontaneity of the ability to, as a student, say, what did you make of that? This is what I heard, what did you hear? And just to brainstorm some of the issues that come up. And I've no doubt, Mervyn, this is equally challenging from the other part of that equation.
Yes, I mean, absolutely. I've got to completely respect Katie's view, because I've not been, studying as well. I mean, what I would say is it was a huge amount of work, and a huge, I guess, stress to make sure that everything, did go online for people. And obviously, we're very aware it's been very difficult for students. And that uncertainty that Katie's talking about has been very, very difficult as well. But I guess maybe going back to a previous point, there has been some opportunities with the pandemic as well. That what we've been able to do with some students is that they've been able to join maybe seminars or discussions. We've had some students joining discussions at Harvard. Now that simply would have never ever happened before for obvious reasons. So it's not to downplay Katie's experience at all, because I'm sure it's been anything but easy, but there has been some positives as well. But having said all that, we've all got our fingers crossed for September, that things are going to be much more normal in September, you know, with hopefully the vaccine and things like that. So it's been very difficult, but it's forced some of my colleagues to look at courses in a completely different way, and which has probably helped. But it's not to downplay Katie's experience or the difficulty, but there have been some positives as well, which has been great that people have been able to join things around the world, which simply wouldn't have happened previously.
Yeah, thank you. And we'll come on to later in the discussion what life might look like going forward and our views on that. But I think that's what you've both said is reflected in many conversations that I have had. And I think there are some positives we can take from this that will enhance experience going forward. But there's no doubt that the majority, wherever they sit in this equation, would like more real face time. And I'm not going to call it normal engagement. I think we've probably almost lost sight of what that means. Katrina, in the creative world, has this given you an opportunity to really step up creativity, or has it put more barriers in place?
Yes and no. It's been hard trying to do homeschooling and manage a job, which I'm sure a lot of people are in a similar position. It's forced me to learn sort of new technologies and things in a way that, an accelerated way that I wouldn't have done had we not had that. And there was also lots of opportunities came up initially for me, photography wise, because a lot of sort of big organizations just weren't geared up for having photography that reflected the current environment. They couldn't access their photographers or their style teams. So there was a lot more work initially coming out to much smaller organizations. So there has been opportunities as well as challenges, positives and negatives, as there is in any aspect of life.
I think the imagery is absolutely fascinating, because of course we went very quickly from historic normal activity into everybody at home, certainly in the UK, most of Europe locked down. And you know, I look back on some of the moments quite amusing in terms of people trying to produce appropriate backgrounds and corporate presentations when you know, in reality they were sitting at home. And we probably had a spell of finding all of that fascinating. We're maybe tailed off again. I'm sure you're going to have new creative opportunities for where we go going forward. And Cameron, moving to you, in your line of business, many probably believe everything could have been done remotely anyway, but I'm sure that, I know it's not true, but I'm sure this threw you some challenges, if nothing else, the absolute volume of demand for your input.
Yeah, I think, so the biggest negative for me has been, and you alluded to it earlier, Bob, those hallway conversations, mm-hmm. that in an office, overhearing your colleagues having a chat and getting involved, and that just environment is been the biggest loss, I think. And we've all been a part of a Friday afternoon Zoom quiz or something to try and get that back, but it's not there. And I think that's still something everyone globally is trying to work to. In terms of opportunities, I think now we can start more comfortably talking about the opportunities out of the pandemic. It felt like a bit of a taboo subject to start with, but accessibility has been the big one for me. You said it there. I can speak to people in Central Europe, in America, if I get the timings right, some people out in Singapore who would never have interacted with us before because people were so geographically focused, not through any ill intent, just that's how we were, and some industries better than others. So for me, that accessibility is also trickling down the way to the people that are maybe coming out of uni or out of school, that people are more accessible, but industries are as well. They can get along to see and feel what an industry looks like through conferences and through various webinars, things like this as well, getting in touch with communities, that's a huge opportunity that's come out of the pandemic.
Do you think we're now more trusting of the technology?
I think certain generations are. To be really blunt, from probably my sister and my brother, they would never blink about using Zoom or jumping on a FaceTime or anything. I think it's been a bottom-up kind of feed to really get that working. I mean, the amount of colleagues that have said, oh, my kids have just helped me get this set up as a technical. I think those skills that we didn't even notice the younger generations kind of had have really come through and are really, really valuable in this slightly altered world that we find ourselves in a year on.
I think that must be right. And just on that point of technology, I should say to anyone in the audience, do please use the Q&A function. I mustn't forget, Cameron's just given me a prompt there. Do put in any questions. In terms of Mervyn, maybe just coming to you on the technology, I know in my own line of business, if I went back to early March 2020, we were still in the zone of somebody in IT was going to fix a video conference, and you would typically begin it not with the old you're on mute, we're also used to now, but somebody hadn't got the dial in or something had gone wrong. Do you think this blend, and you touched upon it briefly, and you know the college has done incredibly well with online learning and teaching people at a distance. Do you think this is now going to become really embedded within the university world?
I would imagine so, yes. I mean, I guess going to your previous point and maybe Cameron's point as well, I'm probably of a different generation, and I certainly was very worried last March that IT wouldn't work or would crash just because, you know, all the universities, all the schools, and it's amazing how it hasn't, you know, I think, which is, you know, highly commendable, but it's also, I think, we're not going back to what we had last January, February in 2020. I think it'll be some sort of combination going forward as well. I mean, I guess a lot will depend in the more immediacy about, I guess, regulations and government regulations. But kind of touched on it, certainly hope by September there'll be tutorials and things like that again in person. And at least there'll then be that kind of interaction, you know, with students as well. But I would imagine going forward, it's going to be some sort of combination of things as well. And I think going to Cameron's point as well, I think we've now got colleagues who are contributing courses from around the world. And it would be sad if that disappeared and if we kind of went back to a more traditional kind of system as well. So I think it will evolve as well over time. But I would imagine it'll be some sort of combination as well, because I mean, the IT's worked incredibly well. And all the changes that have been made to courses, it would be a shame to lose the things that the benefits. So I guess going forward, we just want to learn what we've done well, keep those, and maybe things that, you know, get back to that kind of human contact with tutorials and smaller group work as well. So that's what I would imagine. But again, as I said, a lot will depend on vaccines, government regulations and things like that as well.
I think when you mentioned the vaccine, it's quite incredible that we've got to the point of a number of developed vaccines, and you think back, you know, 18 months, I certainly hadn't heard of the only pandemic or flu I'd heard of was, you know, in the previous century, and we have evolved so fast, and our willingness to adapt has been quite incredible. A question I was going to come on to later, but I think we've got partly into it just now, just with what you've said there, Mervyn and Cameron as well. What does the future working environment look like? That is relevant whether it's Katie wondering what happens after she finishes her studies, or it's any one of us on the panel, or those who've joined us this afternoon. Katrina, you've talked about homeschooling. You've through your career gone law, creative. Have you a feel for what it looks like going forward?
I think that's a tricky one. I mean, things have moved so fast this last year in ways that I could never have imagined. But I just think I still have a lot of hope and optimism once we're past this about the opportunities that are available. You know, we speak about education. I've accessed so many free courses online through this last year that I wouldn't have had the opportunity to do without this pandemic. So yeah, it's looking at that. There's going to be curveballs thrown at you no matter what, maybe not a pandemic, a world pandemic. And it's how we all sort of adapt and move forward and continue our learning through that.
I think you mentioned free courses there, and a word of advice for anyone listening in is the question, what did you do during the pandemic? And I'm not trying to sound like an extra from Dad's Army or something, but what did you do during the pandemic? Thinking about a response to that is going to be really important. I followed some courses, or I took time to do this, is going to be a really important answer. Katie, you're the one who's had to experience student life so far removed from, say, my own experience of it. And yes, I can still remember my student days. Have you a view on what you think this is going to look like?
Yeah, so I mean, I'm going through the job search at the moment, and I'm not as heavy in it as I will be in like a month or so, because I still am going through exams. But it's the market's so saturated, because not only are we having 2021 leavers looking for jobs, we've got 2020 leavers who have graduated in the middle of it all, and then potentially even 2019 leavers who decided to take a year out, or had a part-time job for 6 months whilst they were looking, that are now looking for full-time work. So there's so many people looking for jobs, as well as those that maybe perhaps came redundant, unfortunately, due to the pandemic, now looking for entry-level roles, because it's a career change for them, or the opportunity for a career change. So what I found is looking through the job search, it's really, really difficult to find a niche area that you want to get into without having something above and beyond everyone else, because everyone has a degree, or everyone's got 1 year experience in a marketing role, or whatever it may be. So I think what we're coming back to is like what to do in the interim, what to do in this time that we have nothing going on, or that you maybe give yourself 4 months that your exams are done, or before I go to university between school, what am I going to do in that interim? And I found attending webinars really useful. I've done a few on how to like self-brand on LinkedIn, how to connect with networks on LinkedIn. That's been really useful ones. Upskilling in general. So as I mentioned, I've got a passion for languages, so I'm looking at like online language courses. British Sign Language is one that I'm going to start in the next couple of weeks, which is probably not something I would have looked at, immediately when I was in the middle of a job search, but it's looking at what to do side by side everything else that's going on, because we do have this extra time at the moment, or we have had it over the last year or so. Reaching out to other people, seeing what they're doing, getting inspiration from other places. It's not all about the job search, I'm finding, but it's the other things.
And I think there's a really important message in all of that, which is around resilience and perseverance. Now that sounds awfully easy to say from, say, my career line when, I'm not at the beginning of my career, but I think looking at the disruption and seeing it as an opportunity, it is easy to say, but to live and breathe this, I think you have to be willing to recognize that it's about stepping stones, and the first job might not be the dream job, might be a stepping stone to something else. And I think Katrina and Mervyn earlier particularly touched upon the learning, the adapting, the working, and being willing to say this is not an end in itself, but this is a stepping stone. I'm going to learn from it. I'm going to work hard at it, and be willing to adapt, I think is really, really important as a part of that. And Mervyn, coming back to you, in the university, you clearly have a massive alumni body. I'm sure over the years you've seen people rise to prominence, maybe at times, dare I say, unexpectedly. Others who you've seen who almost were always going to achieve brilliance, and others who just quietly got on with things. Have you any thoughts there on that beginning, the career and?
Yes, I mean, I think the point you made is really important, that it's probably not a straight road for most people. It's probably the best way to say it. Mm-hmm. That you're probably going to have to take some side steps to get to where you want as well. But I think, as you know, everybody's been saying as well, it's taking advantage of opportunities as well. You know, that to do that. And I think a really important thing as well is that, you know, you never know what something's going to lead to. So if you get the opportunity with something, take the chance, because it might lead to somewhere you don't expect, but somewhere, you know, that you ultimately end up wanting to be. And I think a really important thing as well is, you know, with jobs and first jobs, it's to almost display just like a can-do attitude. You know, you don't want to get a first job and then go in and start saying, well, I don't want to do this and I don't want to do that, because you never quite know where things will lead. So it's just trying to take advantage of opportunities as well, because you never quite know where that opportunity might lead to as well. You know, it might be a side kind of road again, but it might end up leading to the dream job that you do want. So it's just trying to take advantage of things and not, I guess harm yourself by not trying to take advantage of those things that might come available.
If you don't mind, I'm going to just jump in and pick up on what you've just said, Mervyn, in terms of attitude. So where we in the data lab try and advertise roles and get people into employment, so many people have taken a step away from aptitude and are hiring people for the attitude they now have. It's their want to get involved, their drive to succeed and deliver what they're asking them for. And because things are more accessible, they're saying, well, we can train them to be what we ideally need them to be. But starting with that really great attitude is better than anything else now, especially when we don't know what 3 months' time looks like. If they're able to change and they want to adapt and they want to be there, that's worth way more.
Absolutely. You always want people in the team who've got the right mindset and are willing to do that. Katrina, when you managed to, I'm going to be cheeky and say, escape from law, as somebody who's still in law, I think I can use that terminology. Did you find some of this helped you as you moved in a different direction?
Yeah, I mean, I still took a lot of that learning because I was moving into dealing with kind of contracts and negotiation initially. It's all about that transferable skills, isn't it? And like the positive mindset. And I would also say finding mentors and cheerleaders, that has been a huge part of my journey. And not just people that say, yeah, you can do that, but people that challenge you and push you to be your best as well. Surround yourself with those people or seek them out, you know, and if you can't find them, then seek out things like TED Talks or volunteering opportunities that might give you that and might help you get over that barrier.
I think as well, there's an important element here. I always encourage, whether it's younger colleagues or my peers, be curious about everything around you. That doesn't mean be questioning, that's a very different thing, but be curious, and there are always people who will recognize your interest in an area and be willing to share that interest with you. And the other thing I think we particularly had to learn with this sort of format is, the use of these, the two ears, you know, listen really hard and listen to understand, not just to reply. And I think there's no end to the amount of support that people will give if you're enthusiastic, you're curious. And, you know, we touched upon, and Cameron, you spoke about this earlier, one of the things that does worry me a little bit about this current environment, because you're not proximate to people, the curious can't always ask the obvious question, which comes up spontaneously. But what I would say to all of our listeners this afternoon is there are always people out there, even if you're not right beside them, who will respond well to curiosity and enthusiasm. So when somebody says, by all means, you know, ask me about it or come back to me, drop me an email, send me a text, and I'll reply. Do not be shy about that. Grab that opportunity. And we cover If you look at the class of whatever we were, 30 plus years in this group, I think all of us would say, if somebody's curious, of course you're going to engage and help them and support them. So I think that's a really important point. And Mervyn, I'll maybe come to you with this one. You're surrounded by curious people. If you could go back to your mid-20s, is there a question you wish you'd asked at that time?
Well, I'm looking forward to getting to my mid-20s, Bob, is the cheeky answer to that. I don't know. I guess I've been very lucky the way it's worked out. It does take a long time to get to places as well, but I don't know if there would be... I'm not sure. I think I've probably been very fortunate. And again, Katrina touched on, I've just been fortunate as well with, you know, people at key points encouraging you, you know, almost like mentors as well. And that's always very important when you start maybe questioning yourself a little bit. So I've been very fortunate as well. I guess there's maybe one thing which maybe relates to Katie. I do sometimes think when I was at university, I should have done languages. I had to learn languages later for what I've done. And I think that's maybe one thing I would certainly question myself about. It's probably, you know, I kind of wish I'd maybe done that actually at university through my first degree as well. Because I think that's a really important skill to have regardless of what you do.
Does that maybe come back to that point about passion? And if you think there's something that you really have a passion for, follow it and at least keep it in sight.
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. I mean, I might not have said it, but I think that's really the key thing that, you know, there's various aspects of my job, but I do really enjoy the part of the research. And that actually goes back to, I guess, what I was doing at school at Robert Gordon's. And as I said, it's evolved. It's always that kind of passion. So when you get frustrated with the other parts of your job, it's always nice to kind of remember that bit as well, which is really important to do as well. And to remember why you are doing the job you're doing as well. But I've been very fortunate with that.
A question in the old days when you could actually stand in front of an audience and be in a group talking, a couple of times doing careers things at different schools, I'll say it's not just been the college, somebody would always ask, and I'm afraid it was always a boy, would put his hand up and say, how much do you earn? And my answer to that has always been, that's a really dangerous road to go down in life. If you pursue something because you think it will be remunerative, very few people are successful at something that they're not really interested in and have a degree of passion for. Now, we've got some great questions coming in. I'm just glancing across at both the chat box and my questions, but if you do have questions, please fire them in. And I'm going to come to one of the questions. We've touched upon this to an extent, but internships, how has the pandemic impacted internships? I'll maybe give a starter for 10 on that in terms of the legal profession, the larger firms and the smaller firms, where possible, have really worked hard to try and bring about a COVID internship. And I think generally done a very good job, but you cannot get away from the fact that you're then asking somebody who's learning and wanting to soak up information to engage with a white dot. And it's harder to bring your humanity to the white dot if you're bringing in an intern than it is to be able to see somebody in person and say, right, this is the team you're with, ask any question anytime, here are some tasks to get on with. Cameron, maybe coming to you, have you had any interns during the pandemic?
So as the data lab, we sponsor about 160 master's students every year in Scotland, which is a really fortunate position to be in. And as part of that, for their master's dissertation, we try to get them out into industry to it's not quite an internship because it's their master's dissertation, but it's on the similar vein. We're in a really lucky position as an industry working with data and digital. Over the last year, the appetite for those skill sets have, funnily enough, gone through the roof. So there are people clamoring to get the right person into their organization. But saying that, there are the challenges that came with that. So last year, we placed a very small number of those students because everyone was just getting used to how to deal with onboarding people remotely, getting them integrated into a team, and making that successful. Now, this year, we have had one of the best years we've ever had with our students. People are comfortable working remotely. It's meant more students are available to more places. So if you're an Aberdeen-based student, they've been able to work in the borders and work with companies outside of their commute area because they've been online. We spoke about it before, though, those hallways conversations. That's been the thing that's kind of stuttered people. And interview processes, how do you get yourself across in an interview? And that's something I think everyone's still trying to work with. I think if you've, and we've spoken about it, how do you get yourself to be the right person for an organization? And I think if you've got the attitude and you've got, you're showing that you're trying to make yourself more valuable and bring something different and extra to a role, there are definitely still some really fantastic opportunities out there.
Mervyn, in terms of the universities, obviously the job market is critically important. Have you seen a change in engagement from employers in the way they're engaging with the universities around graduates and internships?
Yes, there is a bit. I guess as well, more generally, being social science, it's not a vocational degree. The three degrees, but it's aspects within the degrees that employers are interested in. So yes, there's been interaction. There's the kind of critical thinking and things like that. And again, as Cameron said, a lot of it's obviously online at the moment, but there are still opportunities for students as well. So they are engaging slightly differently. But again, I guess it's what we've been talking about all along. It's these different skills that we're learning. I guess as I was talking to a colleague who's involved in the postgraduate program on museum studies, and I believe the Art Gallery at Aberdeen is just about to open up online opportunities for people to volunteer. So I think that's really important as well, because although it's maybe a little bit different, it probably maybe goes to Katrina, people will be learning about digitization with museums and things like that. So it's different skills that people will be learning as well. So there are, exactly as Cam said, still the opportunities, and maybe people get kind of slightly different skills from normal. As well, but it's, as Katie's described, it's not easy for people as well, but it's just to keep believing in yourself.
And in fact, I was going to come to Katrina with partly that point, so maybe there's anything to respond to Mervyn on there, and then there's a question I was going to ask you, which is one of the ones that's been posed.
No, just agree. It's just... it's looking at this is such a big change for everyone. This has affected everyone. So we're all in a similar position in terms of the challenges, but particularly for the kind of age group that the students are in, they're facing really big challenges here. It's your adaptability. This is going to set you up for life. You're going to have curveballs thrown at you all through life. And the skills that you're learning through this in terms of resilience and flexibility and adaptability is just going to serve you so well going forward. Again, it's that taking that positives out of what is a challenging situation.
Yeah, I think I said at the start, we've probably all had experiences in the last year that we'd rather not have had if we'd been asked in advance, but it's taking the most from them. So a great question that we've been asked is about your extracurricular activities. That sounds rather CV heavy, but thoughts on that and the relevance of your extra curricular activities in the job market, finding your way forward. I'll maybe say right from the off before going to the others, I always think it's critically important to have a range of activities and to celebrate them. If it so happens that the things that everyone else is interested in, that's great. If it's something that is less mainstream, then celebrate it. And it's all about, learning about the job market, the area you might work in, but also celebrating your own individuality, and I'm not yet saying we're in the utopia that if the job market doesn't fit you, then it's their loss. But you know, do bring your whole self to whatever you go after, because again, it's back to this point: if you don't have any passion for something, you're unlikely to do really well at it. And if you're not bringing yourself and all your interests to your workplace, it's frankly stifling. So I don't know if anyone else has any thoughts on that question about extracurricular interests, activities, and how they might help you.
Well, just through my job search, I've come to realize that it's tailoring not only the CV to the passion points you've got, because you're going to talk more enthusiastically naturally about them. That's all fine and well. You kind of do that anyway, even if you don't intend to. But what I've noticed more, and what grabs people's attention, or where I've had the most success, is in places where I've researched the company and their core values, and not necessarily just listed those core values on my CV, but tied in my extracurriculars, my passion points into those core values that company has. And it's not something that, you know, is easily done. It takes a bit of time to kind of, you know, elaborate your CV a bit more, but it gets the attention, because not only does it show that you've researched the company, it also shows that you've got a connection to that company. And you can tailor anything in reality. You know, everything's going to have like some sort of link that you can say, right, I'm really into mountain biking. How does that relate to like a teamwork core value of a company? You know, you're always going to be able to relate that somewhere. But that relation, I find, you know, relating those extracurriculars to the company you're applying for, the job role, is where I've seen the most success.
Absolutely. I have a question which I'm going to put specifically to you, Mervyn, and we briefly went around this early on, a specific question about advice for anyone who feels they've embarked upon their own course and they're not enjoying it and there's something else they'd like to do. Any quick thoughts there, please?
Yeah, I mean, it depends on the nature of the degree. I saw the question as well that Alan's son's done, but it's norm, or it can be incredibly easy to change a degree. In first year, if you're doing a general MA, you're registered for a certain degree, but you're actually fulfilling requirements for other degrees at the same time with those extra courses. So depending on the nature, it can be very easy, but even with some of them that are maybe a little bit more difficult, it's still absolutely possible to change. And certainly, I think, as I saw the question, if your son's just in second year, it's still easy to do. I mean, again, obviously, I don't know which university is, but if Ellen wants to email me, it's just, I'm more than happy to help. I spent a lot of time dealing with exactly that question with students. I'm more than happy to help. If she wants to email me, I can certainly do that.
Thank you, Mervyn. That's hugely helpful. And I know, having been a university governor, I always say to people, universities want to keep students who have matriculated. Don't have the mindset that, you know, they're desperate to get rid of you. They want to keep you and have you doing something that will be fulfilling. So we're coming towards the end of our session, and there's always a challenge in how you wrap this up with a question that everybody could pick up. So I'm going to just say short answer, and it may well be a summary of what you've said already. What would your advice be to anyone on choosing the right study and career path? I'm just going to go around everyone very quickly, and starting with Cameron.
I think try it all out. Everyone and everything is so much more accessible now than we were a year ago. Get involved with webinars like this, get involved with industry level activities, get involved with people. I'm much more likely to reply to a LinkedIn message now than I was a year ago, because that's the world we're in. So make use of that accessibility and make use of the network that you can build through doing that.
And just on that, I'm going to give a promotion for the development committee and also the wider Gordonian community. There's a huge body of people there really willing to help and engage. So, you know, don't hesitate, anyone who's on this or your friends who ask what was it all about, you know, do seek some help. The Gordonian community has got some very, very experienced people all around the globe who want to see you do well and help you. So that's my plug there. Katrina, coming to you.
I think my big thing would be, like, don't be afraid to take risks, follow passions, make mistakes. Don't be afraid to make mistakes. And yeah, go with it. Life is kind of changeable and unexpected, and things are going to happen that you've never been able to plan for, no matter how much of a planner you are. So just, yeah, not be so rigid, flexible, and a positive mindset and self-care through this.
Thank you. And I think, you know, the pandemic has a lot of people finding it really hard because life seems so uncertain at the moment. Yet the reality is life always had uncertainties, and they've just been highlighted rather starkly to us. Katie, coming to you, it's maybe unfair to ask you the question.
I'm not sure I want to be offering advice quite yet, but what I would be saying is, from my point of view, look about the time you've got that is the middle ground, when you're not so much doing anything rigid. You know, you may be at university, but you've got 3 lectures a week. Look at that time. What can you do in that interim that's going to make you improve yourself, you know, self-improvement and self-care, like what Katrina's saying, but also on the job point of view, something you can tailor to a future career in anything. And, you know, all these skills are transferable. If you're learning a language, if you're learning to code, if you're taking up a sport, they're all transferable skills and come with those skills. So find the time for those kind of passion points, I'd say.
Thank you. Mervyn, over to you.
I guess it relates to what Cameron said as well. Probably the best piece of advice I was given was just when I left school by my best friend from school's elder brother, who's 5 years older than I am. It was just to try things. You know, you can try things, you go along, and if you don't like it, you don't go back. But just try different things is really important as well. Go with the things you enjoy, and being important, kind of go back to that point of passion. And I guess the big point as well is just to believe in yourself. It's, you know, as Katrina said, it's not going to be straightforward, but, you know, as long as you believe in yourself and you know you've tried your best, that's the, you know, you can't blame yourself if things don't work out, as long as you've done that. So it's just, I think believing yourself is really important as well.
Absolutely. Well, thank you. And, you know, final reminder, do engage with the development office if we can help, the community can help with you at all. There are questions that have been posed this afternoon we haven't had a chance to answer in this discussion. Again, we'll try and follow up and give you answers to these. So I'm about to simply say to the panelists, thank you very much, all of you. You've shared lots of insights. I'm sure we could talk for a lot longer, but people have an attention span. We've given a time schedule. So on behalf of everyone in the development office and the wider college community, a huge thanks to all of you for giving up your time this afternoon to be with us. And I'd like now to extend a very warm welcome to our mystery guest in the form of our head of college, Robin McPherson. So Robin, warm welcome to you and good afternoon. I think you've listened into some of this, so over to you.
I have indeed. Thank you, Rose. I'm not sure I quite qualify as mystery guest anymore, having appeared to all of these so far, Bob, but playing my role of intellectual magpie, as I have done, it's been great. You've been scrolling things down in a fantastic session. Again, thank you to all our panelists for your insight. And just think the range of experience there and the advice at the end, absolutely terrific. I just think one of the themes that's really developed out of this that I'm interested in is maybe we should spend more time talking about the need for people to develop different careers throughout their working life. Mm-hmm. I think we still talk an awful lot about this, you know, how do you prepare people for jobs that don't yet exist, but that debate actually is about 70 years old. That narrative was, you know, back to the 1950s. So I think looking more at how the job market is changing is that people will typically have 6 or 7 different careers now. So how do you prepare for that is probably a better way of thinking than trying to.
I think that's absolutely right. And now, Robin, we may have had.
For 50 odd years. My mum worked for the NHS for about 50 years, and that was her sole employer. And those days are gone. You know, people don't work for one firm or one profession anymore. You know, they chop and change quite a lot and go in different ways. So I just think that flexibility and the advice given there, just to engage with lots of different things and being the best version of yourself that you can be. People have got multiple talents to explore them. So I thought that was a great session today, and I've taken away an awful lot, and you know, so much, I think, for people who've been tuning in to also go away and reflect.
Well, thank you very much. And we promised we'd finish at 5:30. So I'm going to just briefly touch upon a couple of the things which have come through. Follow your passion. Not every moment of what you do will feel as if it is 100% aligned with your passion, but make sure there's a good percentage of it. Be willing to try different things. Recognize that every position you take, whether it's, my first job was on a building site, and there are things I learned there that I take forward today. Resilience. It doesn't come on its own, but take it from the community around you, your family, your friends. I've said a few times this afternoon, the Gordonian community, access them through the development office. Enjoy what you're doing. Look out for those around you. And it does look difficult at the moment, but I can assure you there are some great opportunities out there that come from the disruption that we're living through. So, to all of you, good luck, stay strong, stay in touch with the community, and thank you very much for joining us this afternoon. So thank you very much, everyone, and have a good evening wherever you are. Thank you.